Good day. Welcome to the 11th lecture of metal forming. In the last class, we discussed the introduction of forging process. As you know, in metal forming process, the forging is a important metal forming process commonly used in industries for producing varieties of products. So, in the last class, we discussed the about the forming operation. We can classify the forming operation into three, basically open die forging process. Second, closed die forging process. The third one is the semi die or semi impression die forging process. So in this class, we are going to discuss the different types of forging operations, because for manufacturing a particular component, we need to do different forging operations in a continuous manner. Then only we can convert a raw material to a final product. So the operations or the forging process involved in transforming a particular raw material to final product involves a combination of different forging operations. So today in this class, we are going to discuss this type of forging operations. So the first operation is upsetting process. In the upsetting process, what happens is that increase the thickness or diameter of the material and to reduce its length. So as we know, during the forging operations, there is no change in volume. So any change in dimension of the raw material during the forging operation will increase the other dimensions. Okay, so here the any reduction in length, the length is reduced. So any reduction in length is compensated with the increase in thickness or diameter during this upsetting forging process. So next I will show a for upsetting forging process here. This is actually commonly we use open die for upsetting forging process. So here we can see
is performed on ingot, billet, bar or a preform, and is the deformation of a work.
See this here, in this is a hot forging process in an open die, and here we can see after the forging process, the length is reduced and its diameter is increased. So this is called a upsetting process. Commonly we use this upsetting process for making the head of the bolt. So when we make the head of the bolt, we decrease the diameter, length, and corresponding the material in the length area is shifted to increase the diameter. So that is the upsetting process.
Is performed.
Next process is drawing out operation. In this, the thickness of the bar is reduced and corresponding reduction in the thickness is thereby the length is increased. So that is the drawing out operation. So we can see the drawing out operations here. So here we can see when subjected to hammering, the thickness or the diameter of the workpiece is reduced, and the reduction in the diameter or thickness is compensated with the increasing the length of the workpiece. So that is the drawing out operations. Third one is called a fullering operation. The fullering operation is actually used to distribute the material from the center to the outwards non-uniformly. Okay, that is the fullering operations. For example, consider a workpiece like this, a rectangular cross-section workpiece. I want to change the material from the center region to this end region. For that, we can use a die like this. We can use a die with a shape like this. So when we press using a die like center position, what happened? The material from the center region is moving outward non-uniformly. So finally we got a shape like this. So the center region will be thinner compared to the end regions. So this process is called a fullering process. This is a non-uniform reduction. So after the fullering operation, we can see the final product will not be of uniform thickness. In some region, the thickness will be reduced. So that is fullering operation. There's another die which is used for fullering. See this, here the thickness is lower. So the material in this region, when we press using this set of dies, the material in this region moving this direction and fill in this region. So in the ender region, material is thickness is higher than that of the center region. That is the fullering operation. We can see the fullering operations here. Okay, so see this, after fullering at a particular localized area, the material is reduced and the material flow from this region to outward flow we can see here. So this is called a fullering. Next process is edging process, which is similar to the fullering process, but here the material from the central region that is localized, okay, the material is collected locally. Anywhere in the workpiece, it is not strictly at the end of the workpiece, but anywhere in the workpiece the material is localized. So this process is called a edging process. That is also a intermediate process for the manufacturing of the or forging of the different components. Edging process, we can see the difference of fullering and edging. Here in the fullering process, from the sinter region the material is flowing outward, but in case of edging, here we can see the material from this region is flowing to the central region. Okay, so we locally we collect the material in the edging process, and we distribute the material from a particular location to outward using fullering operation. These are the two other operations commonly used in forging. And the one of the important operation is swagging or blocking, and swagging or blocking is used to create the approximate shape. So when we manufacture any component, after fullering, edging, etc., we drawing out, etc., we need to create approximate shape of the final product. For example, in case of a connecting rod, when we make a connecting rod, after edging, etc., we do this swagging or blocking process. After swagging and blocking, we got an approximate shape of the connecting rod. For that, we use a die, say cloth die forging process. So here we use two dies, and there is a cavity in between these two die which is similar to the final product shape. So when we press the raw material in between these two die, we got a shape which is exactly similar to the cavity shape. So we got approximate shape after swagging process. So we can see in this video, here we have a die with a particular cavity. So by hammering or by pressing, we got the shape of the die. We can see that.
As having several impressions for sequential preforming and finish forging operations.
See this. After this, we got an approximate shape of the final component. So this is called a swagging process or blocking process.
As having
next process is bending process. In order to create a bend in form of circles, ovals, or angles, we use bending operations. So for that, we place the workpiece on the anvil, then we hammer this workpiece against the anvil, and we can bend the workpiece according to the shape of the support. Okay, that is bending operation. Here in this, we can see a hammering of the workpiece for bend the edge of the or end portion of the workpiece. We can see here. So this is the bending operation. So depend upon the shape of the anvil, so we can see different areas of the anvil, and we place in different areas of the anvil for different radius of curvature for the final bending. So we hammer the workpiece against the anvil for bending. That is also an important operation. Next one is cutting or trimming. After the finishing operations, in the previous class I discussed, some flashes are created in case of cloth die forging. So this flashes is an extra material. We should remove the extra material from the finished product during the forging process. For that, we use cutting or trimming operations. So we remove the extra material from the final product by means of this cutting and trimming. So here we can see the trimming operation.
Once finished forging is complete, the flash is removed either manually or with trimming dies.
So this one, this portion is an extra material. This is a scrap extra material. So that is removed from the workpiece or the final product after the forging by cutting or trimming process. Here we use sharp tool or die for cutting operation. That is the cutting or trimming operation.
Yes.
And next important process in the process is deep drawing process. This is commonly a sheet metal operation. Here in deep drawing operation, we form a flat workpiece into a hollow shape. So a cup like shape. So here we have a sheet member, and when we apply a punch force here, the sheet member change the shape like this. Okay, so here the change in thickness is almost negligible, but the sheet is converted to another shape by the application of a punch force. That is the, so here we can see a cup shape product can be developed by this method. So here this is the initial workpiece. After this deep drawing operation, we can see some amount of material is moving into this cavity region, and finally at the end of the deep drawing operation, we can see at the end of the deep drawing we got a cup like a final product. So this is a important sheet metal operations commonly used, and here we use a punch. This is the punch. When we force the punch against this the black color one is the sheet metal. When we force the punch against this sheet metal, the sheet metal starts to bend and move through the cavity provided in the die, and finally we got a cup shaped member. So this is called a deep drawing operation. We will study in detail about the deep drawing operation in the fifth module. The next one is the piercing operation. Actually, this is actually the material is moved or a cavity we created by moving the material from the punch area. So here we use a punch operation. The punch is forced against the material. This one is the material. Okay, the material is kept in between in a cavity of the die, and we force the material against this punch. Okay, so when the punch is forced, a cavity is formed here. We can see a cavity is formed here, and this cavity is formed by piercing operation. So here we can see this is the material, and when we force the punch against the material, we can see a cavity here. So we can make this type of cavity by means of piercing operation. There is no removal of material during the piercing operation when we create a cavity. And this is another important operation. This is almost similar to the drawing out operation. This is called coging operation. So here, similar to this drawing out, the thickness of the bar is reduced, and by the successive forging operation, the reduction in thickness is compensated with the increase in length. So this is called a drawing out operation. And next we will see the drawing out operation. This is actually a making of a knife, which I posted in the WhatsApp group. We can see. So this one is an open die forging process. There is no cavity or there is no restriction for the material flow in different directions. So in this direction and in this direction, there is no restriction for the material flow. It can move in that direction. So it's an open die forging process. Here successive hammering operation is given, and here we can see by this pressing, we can see there is a reduction in thickness, and the reduction in thickness is compensated with the increasing length of the final product. See this. Okay, so this is the drawing out operation. So we apply. One more thing is that during this open die forging, we reoriented the workpiece. We can see here in the open die forging, in between the blocks, we reoriented the workpiece. We can see here. See this? We changed the position. We changed the position of the workpiece to obtain the final shape of the workpiece. That is the one of the important characteristics of the open die forging. So that was the coging or drawing out operation I already mentioned in the second second operation was drawing out. Third one is punching operation. In punching operation, as you know, the punching of the paper, when we punch a paper, what happened? One circular piece is removed from the paper. A circular portion is removed from the paper. Okay, that is the punching. So here also in the punching operation, we have a sheet metal like this, a sheet metal like this. When we punch using a sharp puncher, punching die, then what happened? A portion from the sheet metal is removed, and this one is the scrap. Scrap. This is the scrap. So this one is the scrap, and this is the final product. A sheet with a hole is the final product in case of punching. Okay. So we can make a hole using punching operation. So here we can see this is my sheet metal. The gray color one is the sheet metal. By punching, here we apply punching force using a punch. So when we apply the punching force, we can see one part of the sheet metal is coming out as a scrap. So this one is the circular portion which is coming out from the punch hole is a scrap, and this sheet with the hole is the final product, a useful product for further process. So this process is called punching. And the second one is blanking. So the process is exactly similar with the punching. But in case of blanking, this the material which is coming out from the punching hole is the final product. This is the useful product or final product, and the sheet with the hole is the scrap material. Okay, that is the difference between punching and blanking. So the piece which is detached from the strip is called a blanking. So that is the useful product, and the scrap material is the remaining sheet metal. The remaining sheet metal with the hole is the scrap material, but the sheet metal with the hole is the product in the case of punching. That is the difference between punching and blanking operation. Then coining operation, as we know, we make coin using this forging process. So in this coining process, we can make impressions on the die to the surface. We can make a very minute impressions on the workpiece by forcing the die against the workpiece. Here we can see we force the punch, and we can see some cavity on the punch. And when we force the punch against the blank workpiece, actually this blank is produced from by blanking process. We got a blank from here. So this blank kept here inside the die, and when we force the punch against the blank, we can deform the blank like this. So this is the final product with the some impression and projections. Okay, so that is called a coining process. Embossing process. The embossing process is similar to the coining process, but the thickness remains same in the embossing process. We just bend the workpiece into the required shape. That is the only that is the main characteristics of the embossing operation. But in case of coining process, we can see there is a change in thickness. There will be an impression and a projection on the final product, so the thickness will be different in different area in case of final product for coining operation. But in embossing process, the final product will have almost everywhere the same thickness. So that is the main difference. Here we are not change the thickness, but we just bend in different area. Here the straight blank is just bend in this area. Here we just doing a bending by embossing operation. Hubbing process. Hubbing is actually hardened punch is pressed into the surface of the block of the material to produce the cavity. So this is similar to the piercing operation. In the piercing operation, by means of a punch, we create a cavity. But compared to piercing, here we have a shallow cavity than that of punching operation. That is the difference between hubbing and punching operation. Then we have a flattening operation to maintain a flat surface. After forging, we need different types of product. We need a flat surface. For that, we can do flattening process, chamfering process. For example, in this case, in the tip of, in this bolt head, we need a chamfer. So we use a chamfering process for that. Okay. So these are the different operations. There are 17 operations we studied in this forging area. So this actually we make different components by a combination of these different types of forging operations. For example, in case of this bolt. In case of bolt, we have workpiece like this, a cylindrical workpiece. We need to convert this cylindrical workpiece into a bolt. Okay. For that, initially we do upsetting. So when we do upsetting process, what happens? Upsetting and edging also. Edging also we do. So when we do upsetting and edging, the material, the length is reduced and material is concentrated in the head region. Okay, we can concentrate material in the head region. Then after that, we do flattening to maintain the flatness in the head region. So this region can be flattened using flattening process. Then we do swagging process. So the approximate shape we can produce by swagging process. So we kept this this workpiece, the semi-finished workpiece, in a die cavity which is similar to the shape of the bolt. Then we do swagging process. And at the end of the swagging process, we do chamfering to maintain a chamfer in the in this region. So this is the different operations do in progressive manner for getting a or for the production of this bolt. Similarly, for the production of this connecting rod also, we have a set of operation: fullering operation, then edging process, swagging, finishing, trimming. So we can see the different operations performed in the connecting rod. Here we can perform. We can make two connecting rods. See this. We can make first connecting rod and this is the second connecting rod. So we can make two connecting rod using these different operations. So this is the first workpiece material. Workpiece material. Then we do fullering operation. First process is fullering, then edging. So we can see fullering. By means of fullering operation, we can see in different area. We got the material is distributed from a particular region to outward by fullering. Then we do edging process to increase the material amount of material in this regions. Then we do swagging process. After swagging, so this this one, these two are the swagging process. Sorry, this one is the swagging process. So we got an approximate shape at the end of the swagging process. Then after swagging process, we do finishing process. So these two are the finishing process. Sorry, these two are the finishing process. Okay. So after swagging, we do finishing process, and after finishing process, we need to remove the extra material. So this is the extra material. This one is the extra material. So we should remove the extra material, which is actually the flash and etc. So this is a scrap material. So this extra material has to remove from the final product. For that, we use cutting and trimming operation. So at the end of cutting and trimming, we got two connecting rod, and this is a scrap material which can be utilized for next processes. In case of casting, etc., we can reuse this scraps. So that is the different operations performed for the making a connecting rod. So this is the close view. So this is the edging. By edging process, we can make this area, and this is the fullering operation. And this is the blocking or swagging process. Approximate shape is formed. This is the finishing operation, trimming operation. Next is the material characterization. So actually, when we do a forging operation, we should consider the material, because the material, the characteristics of the material is very, or behavior of the material in metal forming operation is very important while doing a forging operation. Because when we apply a compressive load, what is the behavior of the material? Whether it can change the shape during the forming operation, or any types of cracks or failure, fracture may develop on the material, is based on the material characterization. So there are different material variables which affect the metal forging operation. The first variable that affect the forging operation is the material composition. The composition of the material is very important. For example, in some case we use an alloy, and the composition of the different constituents in the material is an important factor which determine the ductility of the material, and which affect the different mechanical properties like strength, hardness, and the crack generation and crack propagation characteristics, toughness, etc., is basically based on the material composition. So we should consider the material composition, metallurgical related aspects of the material. That is the one of the important variable which affect the metal forging process. Second one is the deformation heat treatment history corresponding to the microstructure of the material. So when we do any heat treatment process, there will be a change in the microstructure, and microstructure or microconstituent, microstructure may vary. So this variation in the microstructure, maybe when we do a quenching process, the hardness may improve, but when we do annealing process, its ductility can be increased. So the history, the previous history of the billets or workpiece, the heating history, heat treatment history is an important factor. So we should have a material which has good ductility and good deformation capability for forging process. The flow stress and workability of the material in various direction and anisotropy, that is also important. The flow stress of the material should be minimum. So when the flow stress is minimum, with the minimum amount of compressive force, we can deform the material. So the flow stress is important, and the workability or forgeability of the material. Every material is not forgeable. Some material may generate cracks, and the cracks propagated and leads to fracture during the forging operation. But some material is very suitable for forging operation. So the selection of material is dependent upon the forgeability of the material. So we should select a material which has a high forgeability and in various direction. That is also important. The material anisotropy of the material is also important, because depend upon the microstructure and arrangement of the crystal structure, the anisotropic behavior also will be different. For a polytropic material with a different grain size and shape, the anisotropy, they may show anisotropy. And so this anisotropic behavior of the material also an important factor. So these are the main three factors we should be considered when we select a material for the forging operation. And the important for a given microstructure material, we select a material, the flow stress is expressed. How much amount of stress required for the deformation of a deformed material, that is the flow stress of the material. So the flow stress is expressed as a function of strain. So that is, this one is the strain, the flow stress, the amount of stress required for the deformation. Flow stress is the function of strain, because when we deform or when we do a forging operation on an already deformed material, for example, this is a stress strain graph of a particular material. I take a material which is already deformed with a strain on that deformed material is epsilon 1. So there will be some strain hardening on the material. So the stress required for the deformation of this epsilon 1 strained material is equal to sigma 1. Okay. So the amount of strain already there in a material is an important factor which affects the flow stress. Okay. With respect to increase in the strain on the material or deformation in the material, we should increase the flow stress of the material. Next one is the strain rate. Strain rate is also an important factor which determine the amount of flow stress requirement. Because we can do forging by slow pressing, by means of slow pressing we can do forging, by means of hammering process we can do forging. So in each process, in each operation, the strain rate is different. How much amount of deformation occur per time, that is a strain rate. So that is also an important factor which will determine the flow stress. And third one is the temperature. When we do hot forging operation, the flow stress requirement is very low, because already the strength is very low under high temperature. There is no strain hardening under high temperature. So we just need almost equal to the yield strength of the material for deformation. No much higher amount of stress is required, flow stress is required for the deformation. So when we increase the temperature of the material, the amount of flow stress can be reduced. But in case of cold forging, which is the material is in the room temperature, we need to apply high amount of forging load or compressive force or flow stress for the deformation. So these are the three important factors which determine the flow stress of the material. Then we can make a constitutive equation. What is constitutive equation? That is the relation between stress and strain. For example, in Hooke's law, that is a constitutive equation, the relation between stress and strain. So by doing different tests on this material, by deformation test on this material, we can develop a constitutive equation. So the temperature variation should be considered in evaluating and using the test result. The temperature is an influencing factor for any deformation process. So the temperature variation should be considered during this testing in order to develop a constitutive equation. And workability, forgeability, and formability is the capability of the material to deform without failure. So a material which has a high forgeability or workability or formability, both three terms are same. Okay, in case of forging, we use forgeability. In case of, as a general case, of a deformation of the material, we use formability. For any material, for any operation, we use workability. Both the three terms are same. So the forgeability of the material is basically based on the material. Okay, if a particular material, for example, we take an aluminium, it can be easily deformed. Okay, so we can take, we can consider the aluminium material is highly forgeable material, or its forgeability is very high. But if you take another material which is very difficult to deform, or which is very difficult to deform into a particular product by means of a forging process, the main reason is that when we apply a force on the material starts to crack actually develop some crack, and a crack is propagated and leads to the failure of the material instead of deformation. Okay, so actually during the forging operation we need deformation, plastic deformation, but some material show a crack generation and a propagation finally leads to the failure of instead of deformation. Such material will have low forgeability. So we should select a material with a high forgeability for the forging operation. Okay, so this forgeability depends on the conditions like a temperature. Temperature is an important factor. Maybe a material may be a less forgeable in room temperature, has a good forgeability in under high temperature. Okay, so temperature, rate of deformation, that is a strain rate. Strain rate is also an important factor. Maybe a one material may fracture under high strain rate. When we do hammering, it may fracture without deformation. But if you reduce the strain rate, for example, superplastic material, it can deform up to 22,000 times. When we decrease the slow rate, we use the very slow slow rate, strain rate. Okay, when we use very low strain rate, it can deform to 22,000 times. So the strain rate is an important factor. The strain history is an important factor. Heavily strained material has a less forgeability because already it is a strain hardened material. So we need to apply more amount of flow stress for further straining. So that is the strain history. Then material variability, variables like a composition, what are the different constituents in the material, voids, inclusions, initial microstructure, etc. affect the forgeability of the material. So the temperature gradient is an important factor during the forging process. For example, when we heat a material, in the last rolling lectures I already mentioned this, when we heat the material and during the forging operation, the edge region may subjected to, this edge region is actually subjected to a high rate of conduction and convection, because the edge region is very close to the atmosphere compared to the center region. So there is a chance of high rate of conduction and convection heat transfer in the edge region. So the edge region suddenly, the temperature in the edge region suddenly reduced compared to the center region. So the center region will be hot during the forging, and the edge regions are cold. So this distribution in the temperature, we can see in this picture, in this the edge region the temperature is minimum, but here we can see in this regions approximately 1120 degrees Celsius is there. Okay, so the this temperature gradient which will affect the forming operation. So during the forging operation, we should maintain a constant temperature, then only we can do a uniform forging or uniform deformation on the material without any fracture. So that is about the material characterization. So next is the classification of the forging process. We can classify, I already explained that the best classification or the important classification is this one: open die forging, closed die forging, and a semi-closed die forging. So this is the main classification in the forging process. And the second, based on the equipment used, we use drop hammer or press forging. Okay, so when we do when we need impact force for the forging, where we use drop hammer, we already watched the video how the drop hammer or forging hammer is working. And the second one is the press forging, where we press the workpiece in a slower rate, but we increase the force So that is the first forging. We have these two types of machine depend upon the material and the type of forging operation. We can choose either drop hammer or press forging machine. And the second one is the hand forging and the machine forging. You know, blacksmith commonly use hand forging where they use drop hammer. Instead, they cannot use a pressing operation for forging because when a human pressed against the metal, that force is not sufficient for the forging operation. We need to apply hammering. When we apply hammering, the impact force is much higher than that of the press force. Okay, so when we do hard forging, hand forging, we need to apply the force in the form of hammering. And second one is the machine forging. We have different types of machine after industrial revolution. We mechanize the forging operations. We have different varieties of machines for the forging, machine forging operation. So next we will study these three types: classification, open, closed, and a semi-closed die forging operation. The first one is open die forging. I already explained this open die forging. We need to change the position of the component during the open die forging. The two dies will be, there is no cavities in the open die forging. So we have two flat dies. We kept the workpiece between the two flat die, and we apply the compressive force either by pressing or by hammering. Okay, so this is the open die forging operation, and do not enclose the workpiece. So here we are not completely enclose the workpiece. The workpiece can flow during the deformation. Workpiece can flow in this direction and in this direction. Okay, so but these two direction, the when we do hammering, it can flow in these two direction, but it restrict the movement in this direction, in these two direction by means of this flat dies. Okay, so this is now we are not completely enclose the workpiece during the open die forging, and for in order to get the final shape during for example, this is my workpiece. When I apply constant pressing, what happen? Its diameter is increased and the length is reduced. That is the final material. But when we reoriented the workpiece, for example, after first forging, we kept the workpiece like this, then we do the forging like this. Okay, so we got different shape. So we need to change the position of the component during the open die forging in order to get different varieties of shape according to our requirement. So that is open die forging operation. So we can see this is the open die forging operation. So initially this is the hammering process, then this is the drop hammering press. Okay, so here we can see the change in position of the workpiece. Between each blow we change the position. Okay, so by changing the position we got different shape. All are example for open die forging. So here we can see this is an example for open die forging. Here we have a cylindrical workpiece with a higher length. When we do open die forging, we got a barreled shape output product. This is not the final product, will not be like this. The final product will not be like this, but it will be like this. Final product will be like this. It's a barreled shape product. I will explain about that detail in the next class. So the final product is a barreled shape product. Okay. After single open die forging operation. So this process is called upsetting. Upsetting process. So next one is the impression die forging or closed die forging operation. In case of impression or closed die forging, we have a die with the cavities. Here we can see this is a top die and a bottom die. In between these two die we have a cavity. So we kept the workpiece in between these two die, and we force or we apply the compressive force, and we deform the workpiece into the shape of the die cavity. Okay, so this is the yellow color one. This one is the final product after impression die forging or closed die forging. So the shape of the die is impressed on the component. Actually, the final product will be almost similar to the shape and size is almost similar to the cavity, die cavity. Okay, so that is the closed die forging process. And in case of closed die forging process, we have a important term, that is flash. Flash is formed. So here we can see when the two dies come close to each other, we have a parting line here. Here we have a parting line. So the material has a chance to flow through the parting line. Okay. In order to avoid this flow, some amount of material will flow. That material is called a flash. So this one is the flash. Some amount of material flow through the parting line where we provide some cavity for the formation of flash, and this flash is formed around the final product. We can see. So we should trim the or cut the. This is the flash region. This is the flash region. So we should remove or trim the flash region or material after finishing operation. So we can see the impression die forging.
Impression die forging, also called closed die forging, is the deformation of metal at forging temperature within one or more die within one or more die impressions or capture of metal at forging.
So here we can see this is the actual product. This one is the actual product, and this area, this is actually the flash area. This is actually the flash area. So after the formation, final finishing operation, we remove the flash area from the by trimming process.
Temperature within one or more die impressions or cavities. It is performed both in presses and hammers. Work pieces may be round.
Here we can see three process. Actually, this is the production connecting rod. Here we use fullering edging, and then we do swagging or blocking process. Then we do final finishing operation. So we can see three operations there. So that we do these three operations continuously on this semi-finished workpiece to get the final connecting rod.
Or rectangular in cross section, or flat discs, and the dies are sometimes integrally heated to minimize
we already
edging to refine and fill the shape. The bulk
so
of the shape.
This is the
in finish forging.
Closed die forging operation. And here we can see this is the flashing area, flash production area, this region. Okay.
The bulk of the metal is forced into the impression, while a thin layer called flash flows out between the dies at the parting plane surrounding the forging. Flash comprises a flat region called the land, and sometimes a bulbous region at the end of the land created by a gutter in impression plane surrounding the forging. Flash comprises a flat region called the land, and sometimes a bulbous region at the end of the land created by a gutter in the upper die. The thin flash cools rapidly, increasing pressure within the impression, which assists metal flow in the impression details. Once finish forging is complete, the flash is removed either manually or with trimming dies.
So we can see the flash is removed from the workpiece after trimming. So this is about closed die forging. So here we can see this is my workpiece. After the forging, we got the shape of the cavity, and the flash is formed here. We can see the flash formation. This region is the flash region, these two regions. Okay. So the importance of flash is that when the flash is formed, okay, the further material will not flow in this direction along the parting line. Okay. That is the importance of flash. What is the reason? Reason for that? When the flash is formed, the flash offer very high pressure or force required for further deformation. Okay. So the flash is completely filled in this gutter and land area, and that flash will not allow further flow of material in the parting region. So we got a exact cavity, entire material is filled in the cavity, entire corner regions in the cavity is completely filled by utilizing the compressive force. without moving through the flash region. That is the importance of the flash. So the flash is formed. Here we can see this is the flash produced. Okay. And this is the, we can see the flash serves two purposes. It acts as a safety valve for excess material. So maybe most of the forging operations we give excess material. So the excess material is flowing, actually filled in this flash area. In the flash area it is filled. Second one is the build high pressure to ensure that metal fill all the recesses of the die cavity. Every corner points of the die cavity is filled with the material because of the flash. If there is no flash, what happen? If there is no flash formation, there is a chance for the material flow through this gap. Through this gap. So, the some amount of material may not fill in these corner regions. In this corner region, some amount of material not filled. So, the final product will be a waste one. Okay. So, by the flash formation, we provide a provision or cavity for the flash formation. So, this flash formed will not allow further material flow through the parting line. Okay, so which offer very high pressure for the further flow of material through the parting line, so that thereby we can ensure complete filling of the cavity by the material. Okay, so that is the importance of the flash. Then semi-closed die forging, that is actually a hybrid of the closed die forging and open die forging. One die will be will have a cavity. Here we can see one die has a cavity and one die will be flat. Okay, the upper die will be flat one and the bottom die will have a cavity. So here we can see the semi closed die forging. Okay, so the top die is a flat die and the bottom die is a die with a cavity. So this is actually a hybrid of this closed and open die forging process. So we already discussed the characteristics of forging and the different types of forging operations we discussed. The main one is open die forging and closed die forging. When we compare open die and closed die forging, we can see in case of open die forging, the tool cost is very low. Because in open die forging, we have only two flat dies. Okay. So when we purchase an equipment with a flat die, this flat die can be used for every product. We don't need to change the flat die. Okay. So the tool cost or machine cost is low in case of open die. But in case of closed die, for example, if you want to manufacture a particular product from this raw material, we need to make a cavity or we need to make a die according to the product in case of closed die forging. Okay, so the initial cost for the machining or die, for the purchase of machine or die is higher in case of closed die forging. But when we consider the productivity, production rate, in open die forging, a sudden loss of the workpiece inside the cavity, we can create final product with very less time. Okay, the productivity is very higher in case of closed die forging. But in case of open die forging, we have only two flat dies. So we need to reorient the workpiece, we need to change the workpiece. Okay, and so the production rate will be lower in case of open die forging. So any variety of product can be made with the open die forging. By changing the position, we can make varieties of product. But in case of closed die forging, according to the product requirement, we need to develop a die. A die cavity has to develop. So, it is a cost-involving process. And we can make, in case of open die forging, we can make any huge forging. Big mass forging components can be forged using open die forging. But in case of closed die forging, the cavity size has a limitation. We cannot use this closed die forging for manufacturing of big components. So we have another forging operations like a blocker, that is actually a semi-finished operation, conventional forging, precision forging. We will discuss about that three forging later. So that is the difference between open and closed die forging. So this is an open die forging. after open die forging, the final product is not with a higher diameter and a lower height. It is not like this. The final product will be like this. This is very important in case of upsetting process. This is the closed die forging. This one is the closed die forging. And after the closed die forging, we got this is the flash, and we can develop the final product in the cavity. Okay, that is the closed die forging or impression die forging. So that is about different classification of forging and forging operations. So by different, we can use different combination of these forging operations to make different components. So the design of the forging operation is very important. We cannot choose a different operations randomly. There are specific rules where selection of the or by setting the sequence of operation for the production of a product, we need to use a proper sequence of operation. Then only we got final product without any defect. Otherwise, it leads to a defective product. So next class we will discuss open die forging in detail, and we will analyze the open die forging by using slab analysis in the next lectures. So up to this, I stop this lecture. Thank you.